Could you tell me, first of all, how you first heard about the outbreak of the Falklands crisis in 82?
Yes, my first indication was a round-robin letter from Sir Henry Leach, First Sea Lord, to commanders of squadrons and units, which is about just over 2 weeks before April the 2nd, which stated that we must ensure that our personnel, if they're going on leave, are available for rapid recall and make sure we're all sort of ready for didn't use the word mobilization, but ready to get up onto an operational footing very quickly. We soon gathered from the media that this tied the two up together, that there was probably some action going to take place in the Falklands, and if we were mobilized, that would be why. But then the actual mobilization call came to me in when I was in Gadsby, Leicestershire, at my then in-laws, at 4 o'clock in the morning of April the 2nd, a call from the duty lieutenant commander at Yeovilton in Somerset, who said, quite simply, Sharkey, you are to mobilize your squadron for sea immediately. End of message.
What was your rank and role
I was
at
then
that time?
Lieutenant commander, and I was a commanding officer of 801 Naval Air Squadron, which is based at the Naval Air Station Yeovilton, but had for the previous 9 months been embarked in HMS Invincible, which was our home deck, our home ship.
How did you feel personally when you heard this?
No, very excited. I'd already made a couple of calls to Flag Officer 3rd Flotilla to say, who was my administrative authority, and to say, look, if we do go to war, we need the aircraft repainted and get rid of the white bellies, because you can see them too easily in air combat. And also to get the Sidewinder AIM-9L expedited from America. I'd recently been in the Minister of Defence desk for Sea Harrier, and I knew that we'd ordered these missiles, and they were rather better for low level and combat than the AIM-9G missiles that we already had in stock. And so I'd asked FOF3, the Admiral's staff there, to get on with that and get them hurried along. And by that stage I was really thinking, maybe we're going to have some action, not seriously, but as soon as the telephone call came on April the 2nd, I was really excited. I had a long drive, half of it in the fog, to get back to the base. By the time I got back to Yeovilton, which was about 7 in the morning after being home, already most of the lads were in, and the aircraft were being prepared, and we then got down to deciding what we'd do next, which really was pause. We didn't want to rush on board. I found out from the air station and direct from Invincible when we were likely to sail, which was not going to be until at least Sunday. This was a Friday morning. And so I told my captain, J.J. Black, through the commander air, I don't intend to embark until at least Sunday, and we'll get on with preparing ourselves here. And he was happy with that, so we actually embarked on the Sunday, having spent all day Friday and Saturday getting ourselves mentally tuned to the task ahead, because it was quite a big task. I had been running the trials unit initially, and then the headquarters squadron, then 801 squadron, and I had the same team of officers and men with me throughout those previous 3 years before the Falklands crisis broke out, and so I and my team knew exactly what was still outstanding on the trials of the aeroplane. In essence, that was mainly test pilot trials of the different weapons to be released from the aeroplane or used by the aeroplane. And we quite simply said to ourselves, gosh, we've got to do those now as a high priority, because Boscombe Down wouldn't be able to do anything quickly. And so that was quite exciting as well, because we had to go through the delivery of live 1,000-pound bombs in various modes, high angle, low level, tossing, leapers delivery, firing sidewinders, and firing rockets, 2-inch rockets. And so very rapidly we cobbled together a program. When I say we, it's not I refer to the sort of my team as a team. The "we" means the 801 Squadron team, and they're a brilliant lot. For example, the air warfare instructor was Ian Mortimer. My senior pilot on the deployment was Robin Kent. And we had other excellent characters with lots of experience and expertise. And when we got down to preparing and doing trials, it was a team job. It was not an individual job. And I was really very lucky to have this lot available. They weren't all quite so excited about going to fight as I was. I wanted to go and fight. I've been thinking about that for a long time, doing all the training, and I was actually early in that year I thought, my goodness, I'm coming to the end of my flying time. Wouldn't it be nice if we had something where we could actually prove what we'd been trained with?
So you'd never been in combat before?
No, none of us had. The only man who'd seen action, I think, on the whole ship was J.J. Black, the captain. That was in Borneo. But we hadn't. But what I was keen to do, and several of my other guys were very keen, was to go and see if we could do as well in action as we could in peacetime. Because in peacetime exercise, we'd done very well. But it's not quite the same as doing it for real. So there was an atmosphere of quite a little apprehension as we set sail. Of course, we were going to miss our families, and they were very concerned about us, and that had an effect. But as soon as we were at sea, it was quite easy for me, for one anyway, to concentrate soul, body and mind, everything, on the job of getting these weapon trials out of the way and getting my younger pilots and the new pilots who had been seconded to the squadron up to speed on fighter combat and air intercept. Because we were supplemented by four pilots from the headquarters squadron, all of whom were experienced guys, but they hadn't been front line for some time. And my own squadron of aircrew, and of course maintainers and engineers, were, in my view then, at least 95% up to operational full proficiency. So I was happy with them, but we had four other guys that we needed to bring up to the same standard, which wasn't a daunting task because they were clever guys, good pilots. But it, nevertheless, it was something in my mind that had to be done over the next few weeks on the way south. And you'll see, if you cross-refer to the book at any time, that quite a lot of the book, the early part of the book, is devoted to explaining how we did the trials, which trials we did. And I think it puts across quite well that we were devoted and dedicated to this task of getting ready for war, and in a sense hoping that Maggie Thatcher wasn't going to be turned away from her intent. I mean, I put in the book, thank God it was her in charge and not Michael Foote, because we may not have even set sail. And it might not be a very nice thing to sort of want to go and fight, because that means you, in one way you could say you're wanting to go and fight, therefore someone's going to get killed, so it's not a very nice thing to do. But I wasn't thinking like that. I was Sea Harrier through and through. They used to call me Mr. Sea Harrier. And I was very keen to demonstrate to a lot of doubters around the bazaars, in the service, as well as in other services, the true worth of this wonderful little aeroplane. And, of course, the biggest thing was to prove yourself. It's all very well being well-respected in peacetime exercises, even on very closely instrumented ranges. But none of us knew how we were going to perform for real once we came under fire. And everybody was slightly nervous about that, of course, some more than others. And interestingly, there was a hell of a lot of confidence in the squadron. And it turned out, sadly, that the only two pilots that I lost, they were the only two who talked with the other guys and said, you know, I've got a feeling I might not be coming back. That was John Eaton Jones and Alan Curtis. I mean, they weren't apprehensive, or they just had this feeling inside them that, I don't think I'm coming back. Whereas never for one second and throughout the whole thing did I ever believe that I'd be shot down or wouldn't come home. It wasn't. That's not being clever. It just never entered my head that that was a possibility, because we were very good at fighter combat. We'd shown that. And we thought that given a fair chance and no bad fortune, there's no reason why they should shoot any of us down in the air. The only way we would lose ourselves or our aircraft would be through accident or through some form of other action, like ground-to-air action, which turned out to be how we lost one aircraft. So I was boiling with confidence, you know, full of confidence, and we all were very rapidly into the swing of getting ourselves ready, as was the ship. We had a very, very happy ship, led by JJ, Jeremy Black. And he set a really good example to everybody. It was the longest time a ship had been to sea in history, without going into harbour or in any way like that. And throughout that time, JJ led from the top by never losing his sense of humour, encouraging everybody, his officers and men at all times, being as laid back as anything, but totally professional in every way. So we had a really good leader and a whole team working together. It was wonderful. We were so lucky. And in my book, I infer that it wasn't quite the same in the other carrier, where different personalities meant there were different attitudes that came out about what was going to go on. You probably appreciate that there's always not only inter-service rivalry around, abounds very much, but also inter-squadron rivalries and inter-ship rivalries. Now, these came up fairly early on in the journey south, the one-upmanship between ships, which was just normal stuff. But what wasn't quite so normal was the fact that, as you will be able to gather from other publications, and I hope from what I've said in my book, that the squadron in HMS Hermes was not confident in their aircraft. They didn't know how to use the radar properly or the navigation computer system. And so they were unable to say to themselves, what's the problem? You know, they actually were... What I'm saying is that they weren't at the same professional standard, and this had come out before the Falklands broke out, because I was, Mr. Number One Sea Harrier Man. They call me Mr. Sea Harrier. And having done all the trials with my squadron, my results were very good. I had to write huge numbers of reports for over the 3 years about the aeroplane, what it can do, what we can do with it. And when it came down to reporting on the radar capability, for example, we managed to do very well with it, better than the designers and builders for Anti had ever hoped. In their trials with their botched-up radar dome on a twin-prop aircraft, they were getting something like 18 miles air-to-air radar pickups on a Sea Harrier. I was angry if people weren't getting 23 miles with the Sea Harrier itself against another Sea Harrier. And if we didn't get that, if it was something under 20 miles, I'd say there's something wrong. The tuning of the radar is wrong, or you're not doing your job properly in the cockpit, one or the other. In the 800 squadron, who'd had the radar for quite a long time, they were getting anything between 7 and 10 mile range pickups on another Sea Harrier. And so, of course, that came from their lack of technical excellence, I think. But they didn't believe what we were getting. And my reports were going in, and my team won operational efficiency trophies and flight safety trophies and things like this. But I found out from various people during the conflict that there had been considerable doubts about me and my squadron. Was he bullshitting? Was he as good as he said his team was? Were these results real, or were they fabricated? Because 800, the other team, initially led by Tim Gedge and then by Andy Old, they weren't getting the same results at all. And they were basically accusing me and my team of lying about results. Whereas what happened was well before the Falklands. When the other squadron was formed, I said, look, we can give you a good hand here, I hear. And when you get the radar, why don't your artificers and mine get together? Because mine are bloody good. And they've learnt what they've learnt over some period of time. And you can only benefit from that. We were prepared to do anything for them to give them an easy start in life, because I was supposed to support them as the boss of the headquarters squadron. No, we can do very well without that, thank you, was the answer from Tim Gedge. We don't need your help, Sharkey. And that was, in my mind, a very significant remark when we came down to the Falklands, because they still didn't know how to use their radars. They didn't trust them. They didn't trust their navigation kits either. So there's certain things going on during the war that they were unable to do, which may sound, I mean, to me it's highly controversial, it's astonishing, but they couldn't carry out a decent combat air patrol, that is, searching for an enemy aircraft, with their radars. So they didn't use them, most of their pilots. And this led later to, you see, they were in Hermes, which is captained by a very good guy called Lynn Middleton, but he doesn't suffer fools gladly. And the squadron commander in Hermes, 800 Squadron, was a guy called Andy Old, who I've already mentioned. And he wouldn't stand up to Lynn Middleton and say, no, this is the way it's got to be done. I'd stand up to anybody. First Sea Lord, I don't care. I'm Mr. Sea Harrier. This is Sea Harrier business. We do it my way. There's no other answer. But he wouldn't do that. And, of course, nor did he have the trust in his aircraft and systems that we had in our ship. And so there you had HMS Hermes with a bloody good captain. Lynn Middleton is a great guy. But he's not a fighter pilot. He's a bomber pilot. And so he needed to be told very strongly by the squadron commander, no, sir, this is the way it's got to be. Well, that didn't happen. Then, of course, you got Admiral Sandy Woodward coming on board with his staff, who knew nothing about aviation, was very unwilling to learn, so it turned out, didn't like asking questions, he liked telling people what to do. And he was gathering his information on what the aircraft should and shouldn't do from those around him on board, including mainly 800 Squadron. But very soon it was apparent that the staff, the Admiral's staff, thought, well, the aircraft's radar is useless. So we were actually told there were two signals during the war from the Admiral's staff to our squadron. Do not use the radar at all for look down for targets coming in at low. The same signal, you are not to use the radar. You are to keep it switched off until you're directed to within 10 miles of an enemy contact. Now, this isn't quite in the book. That's in the book. But what, with a bit more hindsight, I've been trying to think about why. The lookdown I don't understand at all, because on May the 1st we got one good kill and one damaged aircraft from autonomously detecting enemy aircraft below us. But the bit about the 10-mile bits links in very well with the squadron, 800 Squadron's views, that you can't pick up another Sea Harrier or Mirage or whatever beyond about 10 miles. So maybe the Admiral's staff thought, well, why not just stop telling everybody where we are by transmitting on radar and keep them quiet until we get them close to an enemy. Well, I would have none of that. I mean, my operational views and my tactical views are very different from Admiral Woodward's, and on the air side, I would stand up for myself against him on any forum and argue the toss on this one. It was wrong of him to suggest we shouldn't have the radars on at all, because we weren't a beacon. The bloody great radars on the ships acting as beacons. And it turned out during the war that wherever we were, wherever the enemy knew we were, then the enemy air attack aircraft wouldn't come through that point, because they were afraid to, well, first of all, they were told not to tangle with us, not to to avoid us at all costs, but also they realized after day one, after a lot of propaganda or checking the records in peacetime, that we were bloody good at combat. And so those two things combined, and transmitting on Blue Fox at all times on combat air patrol, allowed them in their aircraft to listen and say, oh, I can hear the Blue Fox, you know, we're going to keep away from there. And there's the Admiral in this first signal saying, don't use it, switch it off until you're within 10 miles of a target. This astonished me, and I said, you know, to the captain, no way. And I wrote a paper for the Admiral to educate him on, and his staff, on how to use the aeroplane on cap, and particularly how to use the radar system, why. This went across to the Admiral, but we didn't get any acknowledgement at all. We wrote several papers of varying description on the trials we'd carried out, how we thought the air war should be conducted and whatever. And he did note some of the things and actually used them in the book, his book, as though they were his ideas, some of them. But on the radar side, he obviously didn't get the message. Because later we got another signal. You are not to use Blue Fox radar at all. And this is one of the most amazing signals you could ever imagine in war. There we were, acting as a first line of air defense for the battle group at sea and later from San Carlos. And he's saying, don't use the radar at all. And we'd already, I mean, if we hadn't used it on day one, we wouldn't have got kills. And later we wouldn't have got a kill off San Carlos, we wouldn't have got the Hercules. And the deterrence value that my squadron aircraft put up around San Carlos, the enemy attack aircraft, if we hadn't been transmitting, they wouldn't have known we were there, for sure, at low level. And maybe more of them would have come through. That, as it was, about two-thirds of all the attacks against San Carlos were turned away by Sea Harrier. So deterrence was a very important thing. And for the battle group at sea, not one time did an enemy aircraft, an Etendard or any other, come through an area where CAP aircraft were on task and transmitting. Not one time. And maybe we'll talk about the Sheffield in some detail later, but the Sheffield was hit because the partly there were other reasons which were also the fault of the flag, the Admiral's staff. But the biggest one, at the end of the day, was they took away the first line of air defense of the battle group to send it on a visual search for surface targets 120 nautical miles to the southwest of the CAP position, which was about 150 miles southwest of Sheffield. And so the two aircraft from my squadron that were sitting up threat of Sheffield, transmitting, deterring, and ready for anything coming in, were taken away without a by your leave to Invincible by the Admiral's staff in Hermes. Go and search for, do a visual search for surface contact. Not long after they'd been taken away and gone, there was a big gap there for the Etendard to come through, and it did, and it hit Sheffield. And basically, that's what I said to the press. Not quite so strong terms, but and my interviews at the press conference and on the telephone and whatever, and you may not have seen it, but we made three papers yesterday in quite strong terms, the Independent, the Times and the Telegraph, where I'm accused of attacking Woodward. Well, yes, I am in my book, but I try to, in my book, I'm attacking the flag more than Woodward. That means the Admiral and his staff, because I think A, that's fairer, but B, it gets me out of the libel problem. But, you know, I've been now talking to you about the radar, the navigation computer side, both of which are very important to the successful use of the aeroplane. And it was very, very clear during the war and from reports afterwards that the squadron in Hermes were not happy with it. Their feelings were taken by the staff, who then misused the Sea Harrier assets in Hermes to do all sorts of stupid things, like sending four Sea Harriers at once to go northeast, away from the threat, for 100 miles to use Mark 1 eyeball to search for surface targets. Now, it only takes one Sea Harrier launching from a ski jump, get airborne. Probably don't even have to turn northeast if that's the way the ship's pointing when you launch. On with the radar, and in one sweep, you sanitize that whole area for any ship, frigate-sized or above, because without fail, without question, you will see in any sea state frigate-sized targets and above out to 100 miles on the Blue Fox radar. You can't do it anymore because the radar range scale doesn't go any further. But there you are. So what they were doing, while we were trying to put aircraft up to defend the fleet, and it was very hard work keeping the aircraft airborne, they were wasting four aircraft at a time to go out on a fan search, 15 degrees between aircraft on heading. And the staff was telling them, do that, and at the end, join up together and fly back to the ship. I was actually there in Hermes. I went across exceptionally with my senior pilot to talk to them, find out what's going on. When they were being tasked like this, and I lost my cool, and I said to the 800 senior pilot, Blissett, what the F's going on? What are you doing? And he said, this, we've been told to do this by the staff. I said, well, tell the staff to get knotted. If they want a task done, take the task and do it the operational way, the efficient way. He said, it's not like that over here. And I said, well, I want to see somebody. And Chris Honeyball, the staff aviation officer, came in then And I said, what the hell's going on, sir? What is this nonsense? I used words stronger than that. And he said, that's none of your business, Sharkey. He said, that's the Admiral's staff's business, and if you don't like it, you can lump it. I said, right, I'll leave it there then. Now that was the way the staff were interfering, not on an odd basis, but on a daily basis, with Sea Harrier employment in the air, and also misuse of Sea King anti-submarine helicopter assets to do visual searches within the confines of the force. I know very well that Lynn Middleton was a bit edgy about surface ships. He likes hitting surface ships. He's a bomber pilot, a buccaneer pilot, bloody good one too. And I can imagine that he wouldn't quarrel with the idea that we've got to sanitize the oceans for surface ships. But one thing that isn't in my book again, but should be, because I've, you know, with hindsight, you say, thinking more about that. The Admiral, in his book, makes a big thing of how he fooled an American fleet in the Red Sea he had three ships under his command. I think his flagship was HMS Glamorgan, a destroyer, and he had two others. And they had an exercise where they had to, from a 200-mile range, attack this American carrier group, see if they could get in and hit them. And what he did, which he's very proud of, he went outside the 200-mile range and for a night approach to the American fleet, put all the lights in the ship on and hung lights everywhere to make it look like a passenger liner, and then cruised on in. The Americans knocked out the other two ships, but didn't knock him out. And so he said, look, I proved that basically air defense doesn't work by aircraft, and I could get in and knock out a carrier just like that. Well, that was a one-off. But in his view, I'm sure, because it comes out in his book, he was thinking, oh, they can creep up on us at any time. Well, of course they can't. It depends how you use your surveillance platforms, ships and helicopters and fast jets, to ensure that that can't happen. So with the emphasis on surface attack that they had and mistrust of the radars and mistrust of the navigation systems in the Sea Harrier, what was happening was half the force, with the bigger half too, because they went south with 12 Sea Harriers because of a bigger deck. And our deck, we were smaller, we only had 8. 12 Sea Harriers were being misused most of the time, not just before the war started, but during the war itself. And so, you know, my book is a bit punchy about that. Not as punchy as I'd like it to be. I'd like to be even more outspoken, because one of the lessons that must come out of the war, which I've quoted the main lessons that must come out of this, the action, was know your weapon system, its performance and capabilities, and then use it to best effect, because the Admiral staff were not doing that. And in not doing so, and in misdirecting their aircraft, either say don't use your radar, or worse things still to come about the protection of San Carlos, they took away the defense of Sheffield, allowed Sheffield to be hit, after causing a lot of confusion as well in other ways during that day. And later, in defense of San Carlos, they told the Hermes Sea Harrier boys, you're to stay up at high level.